All right, this is the third video in my homemade semiconductor fabrication video series. If you haven't seen the first two, please go ahead and watch those. In the first one, I talk about the basics of the processes, and then in the second one, I show you around my home chip lab and explain the processes a little bit better about how they can be done at home. And then in this video, I'm going to attempt to make an N-channel insulated gate field effect transistor, commonly known as a MOSFET. This is going to be an N-channel enhancement mode MOSFET. So, before I tell you about the process and actually start doing it, please keep in mind that if you'd like to try this by yourself, you're doing so at your own risk, and it's extremely dangerous, it's extremely hazardous. There's a lot of flammable and toxic and hazardous materials you'll be working with. There's a lot of strong acids. You'll be working with hydrofluoric acid, high temperature ovens, and there's a lot of hazards involved with this. So please do not attempt to do this until you really understand all of the processes and can be very careful and thoughtful about your safety gear as well. When you're dealing with these acids, you should be wearing full protection gear, goggles. You should be wearing not only thin nitrile gloves, but actual thick chemical resistant gloves that are resistant to the specific acids you're working with. It's extremely important. So with that being said, I'm going to quickly go over the fabrication steps to make a MOSFET. I'm going to start with a piece of silicon wafer. It's going to be P-type with a crystal orientation of 100. And I'm going to put that in the furnace and I'm going to grow a 5,000 angstrom, which is 500 nanometers thick silicon dioxide layer. And this is called a field oxide. It's a dielectric and it's an insulator, and we're going to etch and build the rest of our stuff onto this layer. So we grow that field oxide. It can take about 2 hours to do so, and you'll know it's you've gotten to the right thickness when it's a bluish color. You can look up online, there's silicon dioxide color charts, and it'll tell you the color versus the thickness, that the color is due to thin film interference, and the color pattern repeats itself, so you have to know roughly how much time it's been in the furnace for, and you can use an online calculator to figure out which region of the repeating color you're in, and therefore you can get that color. I'll show you that chart in a minute here. And then you can use either electrical tape or vinyl mask, or you can spin photoresist and expose it, but you're going to have to mask off portions and then immerse this entire wafer in a hydrofluoric acid solution so you can etch away these windows into the wafer. And then once that's done, before you do the doping step, to make your phosphorus-containing film spin onto the wafer easier, you might want to do the RCA cleans and or piranha etch of sulfuric acid and stuff like that, because you want a hydrophilic surface so that the phosphorus-containing film will evenly spin coat much easier. It's the reverse as if you're applying a photoresist to it. And then after you do those RCA cleans, you don't want to do another HF step until the doping is complete. So once you have a nice prepared surface wafer that looks like this, then you can spin on a dopant. So we want an N-type dopant because it's a P-type wafer, and we're going to be creating these N-type wells. For this dopant, you can use about 5% by mass phosphoric acid solution. You can put that phosphoric acid in water, isopropyl alcohol, ethanol. You can experiment with the different solvents to figure out what spins on best for you. The other option is you can buy a commercial spin-on diffusant. Spintronic sells one, and so does Emulsitone. They're rather expensive, though. In this video, I'm going to be using P509 phosphorus dopant from Spintronics, and I'll go get that out of my fridge in a little bit. It has to be you have to store it low temperatures, so it has a longer shelf life. So you spin on that coating onto your wafer, and then you put it onto a hot plate, and that'll bake away the solvents, and then that'll put a high concentration of the phosphorus atoms right above that N-type well, and then we put it into a furnace at over 1,000 degrees C for 45 minutes to an hour, and that will not only grow back a small oxide layer over these regions, but it'll make N-type diffusion wells right there and there. So we have two p-n junctions, and then we have a thin gate oxide. Well, it's a thick gate oxide, and then the next step, we're going to etch that down and then grow it back very, very thin. And normally, I've had successful devices mainly with a red to bluish gate oxide. And you don't want it too thin because you'll risk getting pinholes and other impurities in that gate oxide. But and also, if you have it too thick, then electric fields won't be able to be created onto that layer and the field effect device will not work. After you have that gate oxide, you're going to etch two more holes to these n-type regions here, and then use silver conductive epoxy to make connections to the gate, drain, and source, as well as one more connection onto the backside of the wafer, and that's going to be your bulk or substrate connection that's tied into the source. Before we continue, I'll take the phosphorus-containing dopant film out of my fridge here. It's important that you keep it at low temperatures so that you can increase the shelf life of it. If you leave it outside in ambient temperature all the time, it won't last for more than a few months. Supposed to take it out about five or six hours before you plan to use it, so it can come up to atmosphere or to room temperature. First thing you'll need to do is to grow a 5,000 angstrom thick layer of silicon dioxide onto a P-type wafer. If you'd like to make a P-type MOSFET, you could also use an N-type substrate. Now, I've already grown this silicon dioxide layer because it can take many hours. This wafer here has a bluish tint to it when viewed under the correct lighting, and that indicates that it's the thickness that we want. You can print out a number of these charts online. I know that it was in the furnace for about 2.5 hours, which puts it in this range because I was pumping steam into the furnace at the time. Since it's in this range, we look for where the blue is, and it's approximately 500 nanometers or a little bit above, so that's 5,000 angstroms, and we're in good shape. Anywhere between 5,000 to 7,500 is normally all right for a field oxide. You can go a little bit lower or a little bit higher. Now I'm going to cleave this up into some smaller pieces, and then we'll be able to do some masking and etching and fit them into the 1-inch tube diffusion furnace. Maybe you can get a better view now of the color. It's a fluorescent light that's reflecting off of it. Yeah, it's hard to see. I'm going to use a pair of stainless steel tweezers to cleave the wafer, and this plastic one just to hold it down. Yeah, and occasionally bad stress fractures will occur and it won't break right across the lattice line. So you can avoid that by using sharper tools. It's not really a precision process. This kind of bad cleaving is actually more likely to happen after you do this first high-temperature oxidation step, because it causes a lot of dislocations and other kind of fractures within the crystal structure of the silicon. So I'm going to break this up a little bit more into a couple smaller, roughly square pieces, and that's what we use to fabricate the devices. All right, now that I have a roughly square-ish rectangular piece of wafer that has that field oxide growth onto it, I'm going to use the vinyl masks and a hydrofluoric etching solution to create these active areas as such here. This is a piece of the vinyl mask, and we're basically making a dopant barrier so that the region underneath the gate remains P-type, and then we create N-type wells to the right and to the left of the gate. So the thickness that I cut this vinyl at will determine the width of the gate. Got to make sure that it's completely adhered down. And there we go. We don't want to let any little molecules of HF get up underneath that, because then our gate won't be properly etched. All right, cool. Now I'm going to grab about a 2% HF solution and then a couple of water baths. And make sure you're wearing complete safety goggles and chemical resistant gown, and you should be wearing much thicker gloves than these. You also shouldn't have any skin showing. So I now have the wafer with the vinyl mask into the HF solution. And we're going to let that etch for a few minutes. You'll know when you've etched completely through the silicon dioxide layer, when you can take this out and put it under water, and the water will bead up and it won't wet across, because bare, unoxidized surface of silicon is highly hydrophobic. So if you have a surface that will wet across with water and is hydrophilic, then you know that there's still some oxide layer present onto that. And we want to get all the way through that oxide layer, except for in the part where we have masked off. And there's also a visual check. I can see that there's still a little bit of a blue tint, so we're going to leave it back in the HF here. And to speed up the process, you could warm up this solution of HF even with your hands, or on a hot plate if I didn't have it in a plastic container. The etching of silicon dioxide with hydrofluoric acid is endothermic, so if we can add heat, it'll favor the right side of the reaction and shift the equilibrium and basically occur faster. Okay, that's been long enough. Now I'm going to put it into, being careful it doesn't drip, I'm going to put it into the first water bath, and then the second water bath, the water level is higher on it, so it'll rinse off any excess HF that's left up onto this tweezer here. And now the source and drain regions are no longer tinted blue. I made the gate region actually a little bit too thick. If I did this again, I would make it probably about half that, maybe a little bit more than half that thickness, width rather. Now I'm gonna dry it off with nitrogen. Dry off the back side too. And I don't know if you can see, but the water was wetting right across of it, right across the surface without beading up. So we've gotten rid of that whole oxide layer. Now I'm going to peel off our mask, our vinyl mask, and we'll see that the region underneath it is still tinted blue. And then I'm going to clean that in a very dilute HF solution, 0.5%. I'm gonna do a very quick dunk of it in there. You can see that the middle region still has the insulating layer on it. All right, now we're gonna dope the wafer. So prepare your spin-on dopant. You should let it sit for at least 5 or 6 hours so that it's warmed up to room temperature. And then get the pipette ready so we can put the wafer onto our spin coater here, which has some new tape onto it so that the wafer will stick to it. And we're gonna spin it at 3,500 RPM for about 30 seconds. And then we wanna be able to put it onto a hot plate here very quickly after that. If we leave the wafer on the spin coater, then the film will turn white and hazy and the film quality will not be very nice. So we wanna get it off of that without wasting much time and get it onto an already heated up hot plate. We want to put it on the hot plate when it's about 115 degrees C, and then let the hot plate come up to about 220 degrees C, leave it there for 15 minutes, and then we should see the thin film interference color become consistent milky white-ish on top of this. And that means that our doped oxide layer, our phosphorosilicate glass layer, has completely formed, and the solvents have evaporated. And then we're ready to take it off of that, and then we can do diffusion steps. So the hot plate is very hot, about 330 degrees F, and I'm going to put this onto the spin coater, put a couple drops of the dopant on, spin it, and then we'll do the pre-deposition step on a hot plate. Before I do that, I'm actually going to do a very quick clean of this wafer. Okay, so it's been about 15 minutes, and you'll notice that the phosphorosilicate glass layer that we just made has hardened and the solvents have been driven off. And you'll also see that the interference patterns on it are not very consistent, the colors vary, and there's a region in the bottom right of this image right here that's not coated by the oxide layer that we just made. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to strip this off with hydrofluoric acid, and then I'm going to redo the spin-on dopant application, but before I do that, I'm going to do the piranha clean, and that's going to allow for a more hydrophobic surface, and hopefully I'll get better coverage the second time. I'm not going to show that on camera because I already showed you this process, but I'm going to do that, and then we can go ahead and do the diffusion. Now, before you do the diffusion, you can actually get rid of this phosphorosilicate glass layer by putting it in dilute like 1 or 2% HF for about 30 seconds, and you can get rid of this layer completely and put it into the diffusion furnace, and you can still have your end wells will still form and get diffused But I'm going to leave it on. It's not completely necessary to do that step with all spin-on dopants.
We're getting ready to do the diffusion. So I have my furnace here warmed up to about 1,000 degrees C, and that's going to warm up a little bit more to about 1,200 degrees C. I'm going to cap it there. I don't want my quartz tube to get completely destroyed. So I'm going to go grab the wafer in a second here and then put it in the mouth of the furnace and let it stay there for another 5 minutes, and that'll make the rest of the solvents boil off and we'll get rid of all of the solvents in there. And then I'm going to use the stainless steel rod and gently push the wafer into the middle of the furnace where it's the hottest, and then leave it there for about 45 minutes, and that's the diffusion. I'm also going to take the nozzle from that yellow nitrogen tank and position it so it's blowing a small amount of nitrogen through this furnace, and that will allow for a lower resistivity of the silicon wafer once we're done with this, and it'll overall give us better electrical characteristics. So that nitrogen is basically replacing the oxygen. So normally we'd have, you know, 20% oxygen, 70% nitrogen-ish in there. So we're increasing that nitrogen content quite a lot, which is great. So I'm gonna grab the wafer and we'll go ahead and do that. I forgot to mention, when you're doing the field oxide step, to make the oxide grow a lot faster, you can pump steam into the chamber. There's a few ways of doing that. For that furnace back there, I have that access port in the top, so I would actually drip water into that, and then it would instantly vaporize and create water vapor atmosphere inside of that furnace. For this tube furnace, you can, if you have a steamer for like fabrics and curtain, you can blow it through the chamber along with the nitrogen gas flow. An alternative way that works all right is to take a water bottle or a graduated cylinder and then put a paper towel into it and put it very close to the opening of the furnace, and it'll wick and draw that water in, and the moisture content will be a lot higher in the furnace. Now, I'm doing this during the diffusion step so that it grows a small or a thin oxide layer on top of our N-type wells here while it's doing the diffusion. And the reason why I'm doing that is because later it allows me to etch small windows into that oxide, and it allows me to be more precise about where I connect my drain and source electrodes to on the bulk of the wafer. 45 minutes has passed, and I took the wafer out of the furnace. There it is. So I'm going to dip it in HF just to clean off that layer you were seeing. And then I'm going to do another mask. It's going to consist of two strips of vinyl, and it's going to allow me to etch away this gate oxide here so that we don't touch this region or that region, but we etch away the gate oxide, and then we're going to regrow it about 500 to 1,000 angstroms. That's about as thin as we can go with this dirty environment without risking pinholes and things like that. The thinner the gate oxide, the lower the threshold voltage, which is great. I created the mask just like I described, and I'm going to etch that now and then put it back into the furnace, which I haven't cooled down yet. I'm gonna put it back in there and pump steam through it for about 10 or 15 minutes to grow back that oxide. Looks like I actually overshot the gate dielectric layer that we were shooting for. I'll flip to the back of the wafer just so you can see the color easier because it's unpolished. So that's the shade of blue. So that puts us right here on the color chart, which is just above 1,000 angstroms, and we were going for about 500 to 600 angstroms. So I checked my furnace, and I actually left it on too hot, and it went up to 1,400 degrees C, and that's where oxidation happened a lot faster than we wanted. So that's going to mean that the threshold voltage to turn this device on is going to be much higher than I originally wanted it to be, because, you know, this region here for a gate oxide is very, very thick. We'll see how it works. So the next steps I won't show you because it's redundant, but I'm going to use masks to make some openings in the drain and source areas. On this specific device, I made the gate a little bit too wide on this one here. So I'm not going to have much room, but I'm going to create these openings in the silicon dioxide layer, and then I'm going to use silver conductive epoxy, and I'm going to put a big layer of that on the gate that covers most of the surface area of the gate, so that we have two nice big parallel surfaces for that electric field to be induced on. And then I'll make the drain and source connections, and then on the back of the wafer I'm going to etch through the oxide that we just grew, because the oxide grows everywhere, not just in the top layer. We have an equal amount of oxide on the back. I'm going to make an opening for the body or substrate connection. And like I said, that gets tied in with the source of the device. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Okay, super quick NMOS insulated gate field effect transistor test. Multimeter measuring drain source resistance, and I have a bench power supply set to like 18 volts. And as I connect the power supply, as I put positive voltage onto the gate, you'll see there's a lot of leakage current. The drain source resistance when there's no current on the voltage on the gate is about 14 kilo ohms, and then I put on the gate right now, and then five and a half to six kilo ohms. So I'm just going like that and putting it onto the gate. There's two devices on here, two separate pieces of silicon, and I kind of made a mess with the silver epoxy. There were some mess ups. Again, on, off. Okay, sorry about that. All right, so connections from left to right. Source, body, this is an unconnected gate contact, and drain. The body is that green wire, goes up here, and then around back, just hooks into the bulk of the silicon wafer. Multimeter, set to measure ohms. And now let's go between source and the gate. There's two devices here. I was using this top transistor during that demo, and there are two gates on this transistor. I made that because it's difficult to make these insulating gates sometimes because the silver epoxy gets really messy and they get shorted out. So the first gate, this top one here, it was shorted. I'll show you that between source and that gate. Yeah, there's resistance. So during the demo, I was using this bottom gate right here, and we'll go between source and that. And as you can see, it's insulating. Again, that top one, which is shorted, and the insulating one that I did during that demo. Oh, and let's just go source drain real quick. Oh, and something I can do, it's kind of fun. There's a PN junction between substrate and source, or substrate and drain. Because this drain source are in N-type wells, and then the substrate is the bulk of the P-type wafer. So if we go to millivolts here, and hook up my multimeter between substrate and drain, you see about 80 millivolts, and I have a light above here, turn that on, and 200 millivolts. So it works as a photovoltaic.